Welcome to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Be warned, the discussions in this podcast may contain detailed spoilers. For spoiler-free reviews of newly released films, be sure to check out our show on our YouTube channel. Enter at your own risk and enjoy the show.
Take your stinking paw off me, you damn dirty review without remorse. My name is David, and I know everything about the human brain except the way it works. And with me, render unto Joe that which are Joe's. This is episode 103, and in this show we will discuss... New Batman movie gets a release time frame. Suicide Squad 2 gets a director. Ben Affleck gets an unemployment check. Dick Miller, classic character actor with over 180 roles to his credit, has died. Joe and I will look back. The Super Bowl, the big game was this past Sunday. With it came some new movie glimpses? Can't really call them trailers or even teasers. Anyway, here's some glimpses released that we're going to cover. Hobbs and Shaw, Captain Marvel, Avengers Endgame. And then, proving that sometimes a remake can be a good thing, Joe and I sit down to discuss the first in the new Planet of the Apes trilogy, Rise of the Planet of the Apes. How you doing, my man?
I am good. I am very good. Where to begin? So is not saying super something, is that a thing now? Because you're not the first person I hear to do that.
Oh, you can't. The rule is, if you're like some kind of big company or something like that, you can't call it the Super Bowl. If you call it the Super Bowl, you have to pay like a licensing fee. And they're litigious about it as well, from what I understand. They don't want to be accidentally associated with people with companies that aren't officially sponsored to the Super Bowl.
So you literally can't refer to the Super Bowl as the Super Bowl.
Right.
That is absolutely positively stunning. That is absolutely stunning. So I guess someone is can we talk about Avengers Endgame, or can we not talk about it by the name? Do we have to talk
we have to call it
superhero ensemble movie? Finishing.
Exactly. Exactly. The 21st superhero ensemble movie, or 22nd, I think it is.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable. I will never understand the legalities of trademarks and copyrights. I will never get the logic of it, but I'm a plebe, so.
So that's it. What, we some kind of Suicide Squad?
Sorry to interrupt, sirs, but we've got a 10:07 on our heads.
Oh, Jesus, again, Ben?
No bullshit, because I wasn't with a hooker today. Ha-ha!
There they are! Affleck, you the bomb in Phantom, Joe!
So, summer 2021 is the official release date of the next Batman movie, which still doesn't have an official title. With it came the announcement that Suicide Squad 2... is definitely going to be directed by James Gunn. Oh, and Ben Affleck is no longer the Batman. Now, I don't even know. I put this on. This is my week to host, ladies and gentlemen. So I choose the news. We discuss it with Joe, and we figure out, okay, we'll do this. Even after I put this on the list, the first part of me that I thought to myself was, why am I bothering? We know this already. The only new information in this is that the movie is slated for summer of 2021. That's all we know.
Yeah.
That's the only new information. All the rest of this stuff is stuff that we've talked about, we've dissected, and we said it's going to be this. We've known this for months. This is just them finally coming around to, okay, fine, you found us out.
I had the same exact feeling. Again, Affleck, as far as I knew, had already been out for a long time. I swear that we've talked about it before. I guess it wasn't official, but we always knew he was not doing another one. And releasing it summer of 2020, is it 2021?
Yeah.
Over 2 years from now? You might as well just say, anything we've talked about up until this point, forget it. But we still have a Batman movie sometime. I mean, that's 2 whole years. you could spend the first year sitting around doing nothing, and the second year scrambling to make a movie. And I shouldn't even say scrambling, because that's a reasonable time frame. I mean, that's and again, when did they even announce this Batman movie? How many years ago
did we first? 2 years ago.
What's that?
Like 2 years ago, but it was only been the past year that the guy who directed the last two Planet of the Apes movies in the series that we're covering right now, coincidentally, he was slated, Matt Reeves, was slated to direct, write and direct this movie. And the first thing they did was basically throw out everything that Affleck did at that point.
Right. I mean, before that, we were talking about Ben Affleck was going to write it and direct it and star in it. I mean, it's just, and again, I feel like we've been talking about it more or less since Batman v Superman.
I don't believe it actually exists. I think this is all just... I feel like we're being trolled.
It basically, yeah. I mean, it's just like, as far as I'm concerned, that announcement was like, you know, someday we're going to do a Batman movie, which we've known pretty much since Christian Bale hung up to Kate. So, again, that's just a whole lot of nonsense. Mm. I mean, this falls under the category of why do we even cover this stuff? Because it's non-news. I mean, and we could literally be sitting here a year from now with totally different information about who's directing it, who, when it's coming out, whatever, who's starring in it. So it's like, again, they just keep feeding this all, yeah, someday we're going to do a Batman movie, which, again, we know. Well, you're going to keep doing them until we die.
So I'm feeling like maybe this will be the last time we cover it until they actually start announcing cast and actual release dates instead of these weird hints. It just kind of feels like, hey, look, Aquaman just surpassed Iron Man at the box office. We need to make sure people know that there's still a Batman movie coming.
Yeah.
The 12-gauge autoloader.
That's Italian. You can go pump or auto.
The 45 long slide with laser sighting.
These are brand new. We just got them in. That's a good gun. You just touch the trigger, the beam comes on, and you put the red dot where you want the bullet to go. You can't miss. Anything else?
Phased plasma rifle in the 40-watt range.
Hey, just what you see, pal.
The Uzi 9mm.
You know your weapons, buddy. Any one of these is ideal for home defense. So, which will it be?
All.
I may close early today. There's a 15-day wait on the handguns, but the rifles you can take right now. You can't do that.
Wrong.
Dick Miller was born Christmas Day, 1928, in the Bronx, New York. He started his career as a character actor for a lot of Roger Corman flicks. If you go to his IMDb page, you can see that he has 182 credits to his name. He has been on many TV shows, many different movies. Trust me, you've seen this man before. You have seen him in movies before. When you see his face, you're like, oh, it's that guy with that voice. Yeah. an example would be, you may remember him from Gremlins and Gremlins 2 as Murray Futterman. You may remember him from Terminator. He was in the Terminator. He is the guy that sells the guns to the Terminator. Mr. That's a good gun. And more recently, you know, he also was in Evil Toons. He did the voices on Batman the Animated Series. He was in Tales from the Crypt, Demon Knight as Uncle Willie. By the way, Demon Knight is one of my guilty pleasure movies that it's silly, but I really, really love that movie. So losing Uncle Willie was kind of, you know, bad news for me.
Yeah, I think you've told me that before about Demon Knight.
Yeah. Which is why I am bringing this up. There's really, we've seen him before, but he has never really been a notable actor. He's just always been, oh, it's that guy.
Yeah.
And he's been amusing in each of the ones that he in the parts that he did. He died January 30th at the age of 90. And I you know, we complained about the Oscars forgetting people all the freaking time, and that's probably coming up very soon, where they're going to be like, really? You forgot such and such a person? This is one of those people I guarantee you they'll forget. Guaranteed.
That is very true. That's very possible, yeah. But you're absolutely right. He is absolutely a name worth knowing, and he is a face that we all knew from the 80s, and it's a tragedy to lose him.
Tragedy to lose anyone, but this guy, yeah. He was basically, if any time Joe Dante, do you remember Joe Dante?
Yeah.
Anybody remember the director Joe Dante? I love Joe Dante. He's one of my few favorite directors. If there was a Joe Dante movie, he was in it. That was just the kind of the rule of thumb with him. So, all good.
But farewell, my man. It was, you were damn awesome. You were damn awesome.
I'm dealing with the future of the planet. Human evolutionary change.
Who the hell are you?
Bad guy. Who's gonna stop me?
About to show these boys how we do it. You ready?
Higher, further, faster, baby.
Yes, babe.
Some people move on. But not us.
All right, let's get these out of the way. But before we get that out of the way, I gotta get something off of my chest, okay? What we're talking about here are the Super Bowl movie trailers that came out with the Super Bowl. And let's get the first thing out of the way. Has the Super Bowl lost relevance for stuff like this? Personally, yes. I think so. I think this is the biggest waste of money and time ever. Mostly because they charge such exorbitant rates for the frickin' commercials that you don't even wind up with full trailers. You wind up with these, in the case of Captain Marvel and Avengers, you wind up with these 30-second nothings.
Hmm. Yeah, go ahead. The name of the game this weekend was underwhelming. I mean,
yeah,
the game itself was underwhelming, the halftime show was underwhelming. The commercials were underwhelming, and the trailers were all underwhelming. Correct me if I'm wrong, I felt like last year there were so many that we actually spent 3 weeks covering them.
Oh, actually, that was Comic-Con. You're misremembering Comic-Con. It did take us two episodes to cover Super Bowl last year. Absolutely, that was the case. But because last year what they did was they would do these little 30-second trailers, and then they would say, now go to YouTube to watch the full trailers. But now they don't have even full trailers anymore. It's just this.
Yeah. I was so surprised how lackluster they were. I mean, the two Marvels, Captain Marvel, they kind of did this new thing, faster, stronger, better. And I was like, okay, fine. But you're right. I mean, it was just a blurb. I mean, it was just a tiny little nothing. And then Endgame, I thought it was cool because, again, we had a couple of shots we hadn't seen before. And I think the only one that kind of stuck out to me, really, was the shot of there was a few of them walking past the window in Avengers headquarters. And the fact that Rocket Raccoon was one of them, I kind of had a moment of like, okay, well, all right, this is kind of something. Like, I'm finally seeing Rocket Raccoon on Earth. You know, I mean, he's on Earth and he is an Avenger at this point. That was pretty funny. But again, that's not I'm not saying that the commercial was good. I just, you know, you see that and you kind of go, oh, that's what that is. But it was, again, this barely a shot. And again, kudos for them to not give us too much. Because again, I can't have my cake and eat it too. I can't complain about short snippet little trailers and then, you know, complain later, oh, they told us too much in the trailer, the whole movie was all spelled out. So again, I don't want too much, but yeah, it is kind of bizarre how short and quick these little snips were.
Barely a blip. Actually, it's the only good thing that came out of this whole Super Bowl weekend is the fact that after the commercial aired, the Russo brothers both said that they've made a point that all the trailers, any trailer that comes out for Endgame, is only from stuff that happens within the first 20 to 30 minutes of the movie.
Yeah. Which I greatly appreciate. I think props for that. So again, yeah. I don't know if this is a complaint about the trailers as much as it's just an observation that, wow, yeah, the whole game. I mean, usually you watch the game partially for the commercials because the big ad campaigns launch on Super Bowl Sunday. You get these really great, funny commercials that you're going to end up seeing for the next 6 months anyway. But wow, is there really nothing?
Yep. I think there's a shift. I really feel like this is the beginning of the end for the whole power of the Super Bowl, you know, commercial. I don't look forward to it anymore.
Mm.
You know, it used to be every year it was like, oh, I look forward to the Oscars, I look forward to the Super Bowl.
I don't care anymore.
Yeah.
I am not, I was never that huge of a football fan that I was into the game itself. So now that the commercials are lackluster and frankly can be found 5 seconds later without listening to commentary and other commercials and stuff like that, screw it. No, yeah. I'm out.
It's so true. And you know, again, even just a few years ago, I mean, the internet and YouTube is nothing new anymore. But the idea that we would get trailers on YouTube and have to watch them on a tiny little screen or a tiny little window within a tiny little screen, those days are kind of gone because you can now watch these trailers on your TV in high def whenever you please.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
So, screw that noise.
I think you're right. I think the Super Bowl is going to have to, you know, the bargain bin price is going to come.
Yeah, and it's about time. Oh, you know what? We should actually mention Fast and the Furious Presents Hobbs and Shaw, because that actually had a one-minute commercial.
Well,
I couldn't have cared less anyway.
Well, yeah. Well, it's funny, because that one came out a few days before the Super Bowl, so it wasn't like this was a Super Bowl launch, whatever. But, yeah, I looked at that trailer, and I kind of went, like this, again, I think it's done with a super awareness that this is just for fun. It's a lot of over-the-top nonsense. And I honestly have not watched any of the... I've literally never watched a Fast and Furious movie.
And we never will. I swear to God, you ever put it on the calendar, that's when I say we're done.
I have no desire. So as long as you don't, I don't, believe me.
Good. Thank Christ.
I mean, again, there's a time and place for over-the-top fluff. But, yeah. And, I mean, again, this was just so silly. It was just like, I'm watching that commercial for this Hobbs and whoever, and I'm like, I mean, there's a limit to what silliness I can deal with.
Yeah, I like The Rock. Don't get me wrong; I find him to be charming. I find that some of the parts he does, he gives us all.
I do too, and I like Jason Statham. I like Jason Statham a lot. Yeah. In fact, I wish he would pick better parts because he is kind of going down that role. I mean, they're both sort of going down this road of just doing family-friendly nonsense. I mean, Michael Bay style, over-the-top silliness. I mean, again, you know, the Transporter movies are silly. I mean, I don't mind silly, but again, it's just, if it's just nothing but nonsense, I don't know. I mean, how much silly can I take in one dose?
Yeah, you know, and the action is just a little too over the top for me. Mm. You know, the problem is I'm tired of action that doesn't look grounded or at least didn't bring a compelling story beforehand to make that action worth it.
Mm, exactly. I have not. Again, all right, thanks Super Bowl for the game. Again, the game was boring. The commercials were boring, and
I'm going back to my nerdy ways. I'm done with you, football. Yeah. We're not friends anymore.
We're talking about huge potential for millions of people.
Our therapy enables the brain to repair itself.
We call it
the cure.
I want you to start testing in chimps ASAP.
We test one subject. I want to make sure it's stable.
A substance designed to help the brain repair itself gives advanced intelligence to a chimpanzee who leads an ape uprising. Written by Rick Jaffa and Amanda Silver, based on the novel La Planète des Singes by Pierre Boulez, directed by Rupert Wyatt, Rise of the Planet of the Apes. That movie is only an hour and 40 minutes long, and it feels like so much happens in it.
Mm, agreed. There's a lot. That goes to show you how good the pacing is. And yeah, I agree with you. It's a very full, fleshed-out story. It's a very epic-feeling story for what it is, but go ahead.
So what we have here is an interesting little thing. Now, growing up, I was a huge fan of Planet of the Apes. Huge, huge fan. The original Roddy McDowall, Charlton Heston. Charlton Heston was the motherfucking man back in the day.
Yeah.
You know? Like to the point that, like, my mom... I loved Charlton Heston so much that my mom used to call him my boyfriend as a way of busting my chops. So when Charlton Heston died, that was kind of a big day for me. But that aside... Yeah, I loved the original Planet of the Apes. Oh, God, you can watch them now, and you can cringe a little bit. It's still impressive makeup effects that they did, even from back then. But it's, you know, it's a bit silly. But it told a relatively fun and compelling story. I think the first one helped because Rod Serling managed to get his hands in there, and I think he was one of the screenwriters, which would explain the big, you know, shock surprise at the end. Spoiler alert for an over 40-year-old movie, it's Earth All Along. So when I first heard that they were going to be doing a sort of remake, sort of reboot, I was kind of iffy on the whole thing. It's like, who the hell is this Rupert Wyatt guy? Who, you know, James Franco can kind of be hit or miss depending upon his director. Do you ever notice that about Franco? Franco can sometimes be extremely over the top or pretty damn good, and it always depends upon the director. Frida Pinto, and then Andy Serkis, they get Gollum. They get Andy Serkis to come along. Gollum is going to be playing, you know, the monkey. It's going to be all CGI. So I first hear about this, and I'm like, this is going to be crap. This is going to be such crap. I really love this movie. I really, really, even as I was watching it again, I just was like, this is just really, really good. I mean, even if take away the history of the Planet of the Apes as a standalone movie, this is still a good, compelling little movie and still had its little callbacks without being egregious, I felt. The stuff that they do with the motion capture and the apes is outstanding. So outstanding. I mean, this movie's, 8 years old now? It came out in 2011. It occurs to me that this movie basically makes me take that stuff for granted. Because the whole capture system that basically Andy Serkis helped design for these type of movies, that's how we got Thanos.
Yeah, sure.
The fact that he's able to convey so much with the character, you know, they're like, oh, he learned sign language. So you figure, oh, he's going to spend a lot of the movie with sign language. And actually, there is not a lot of sign language in this movie. A lot of his portrayal is in his eyes and his mannerisms. That alone makes this movie outstanding. But then you have the other side of the coin. I felt the story worked. I felt that all the characters played their part very well. Well, maybe not all the characters, but we'll get to that. I really enjoyed this movie, Joe. How about you?
Yeah, big time, which I'm sure is no surprise, but it's funny you mentioned the earlier movies and, you know, I can remember when I was younger, I mean, watching, you know, the original and all the sequels and, you know, of course that the sequels were sort of a mixed bag. And then there was actually a short lived TV show.
Yep. I used to watch that too.
I did too. And I literally can remember being out with my parents one night. And going, come on, we got to get home because the Planet of the Apes is going to start soon. And my mother goes, they canceled it. I'm like, what? She's like, yeah, they canceled that show. And I'm like, oh my God, was I crushed. It was the only thing, right about that night, it's the only thing I can remember watching on TV, like religiously. And yeah, I completely agree with you that when they, again, they're going to dig up another old franchise and monkey with it. And again, this was after, by the way, the one that Tim Burton had done. And I remember being very excited for that one. And, oh, wow, talk about disappointing.
I think we saw that one together, actually, dude.
We might have, actually. Now that you mentioned it, yeah.
I think we saw that together. You mean the ex.
Yeah.
We all saw it together.
I think, when they got to the end, the twist at the end, I just kind of went, everybody else just went, what?
Yeah.
So, yeah, when I heard they were going back to that well, I wasn't particularly excited. But, yeah, having said that, wow, was this a pleasant surprise. I mean, a real pleasant surprise. And it's interesting, too, how well it gels. I mean, again, when you hear... I feel like this is one of the few cases... I mean, I can't think of a better example, frankly... of a film that is a film that is a prequel, but this one, not only does it stand so magnificently on its own, that honestly, it sort of feels almost more like this is the true beginning of that story. Like this, it does not have to, every other prequel, they go back and, well, let's talk about the origins of this or that, and most often it's a pale comparison to what it's actually based on. This one, I don't find that at all. I feel like this is a super strong entry into a bigger series. And at the risk of sounding sacrilegious, I would say it outdoes the original, proud, and really, it's a better film altogether. I kind of feel like the idea, the original is a fantastic film. It is a classic in every way, shape, or form. But this one, boy, does it do it justice, and I mean, can stand side by side with the original without flinching. It is, from beginning to end, just a spectacular film.
Honestly, if the way that they did this movie, at least the way I see it, the way that they did this movie is you could, if it wouldn't have been so jarring, the differences in appearance between the original movie and this movie, you could technically watch this movie and then watch the original Planet of the Apes.
Yeah.
And it would still kind of work because they also hint at the rocket. They hint at Charlton Heston's rocket in the movie.
Yeah, yeah. Yes, I mean, I completely agree. I mean, it really does. It works so well in that respect. I mean, I kind of feel like, I mean, they very subtly hint at it. Honestly, I kind of felt like if they wanted to, they could have thrown more in there. Shown the rocket taking off and even kind of maybe, you know, kind of put a Charlton Heston type person into the rocket, you know, just people watching it on the screen in the background. I mean, I wouldn't even have minded that if they did that. But yeah, I mean, they were kind of careful in how much they wanted to detract from this story with fan service. But I'll tell you what, boy, you're right. I mean, it does segue into the next one spectacularly. I mean, this really does feel like the birth of the story. I mean, we're watching, you know, how this, it's the true beginning of that story. You know, I mean, in a way that the Star Wars prequels should have been, you know, the true beginning to a story, as opposed to kind of like, you know, well, not to get way off track by talking about the prequels, but I mean, any prequel that I can think of.
Which we always tend to do if we do.
Yeah. I mean, Rogue One, I think, is a good example of a story that stands on its own in a way and really does it kind of as well as can be expected, really. This one, to me, really does sort of have more of a feeling of the actual birth of the Planet of the Apes story. You know, I think, again, I mean, you are literally talking about the birth of the first ape. And by the way, I love that because if you remember the sequels, the original Planet of the Apes, they do reference the first ape who could talk, who was named Caesar. And the first thing he said was no. So the fact that they do that here and stay faithful to the original, oh my God. I mean, it's almost like this is the missing, you know, story, the missing first story that was sort of always hidden somewhere under wraps, you know, that they, and then they just sort of started off with the Charlton Heston story. It really does, it works great. And everything you said, by the way, is totally spot on. The acting by Anthony Serkis is amazing. I do feel like there are moments when the CG is a little less than perfect. And again,
yes.
But again, that is, you know, we're talking about A+ down to like just an A. You know, and it's funny too, sometimes I notice like, because it's noticeable because like then the next shot will be back to being like just 100%. Like you literally can't tell. Am I watching actual animals sitting there, or is that CGI? Some of it is absolutely amazing. I love the mixture of different the choices of the different breeds of monkey, the big giant gorilla versus this kind of ape, and there's the orangutan who's got the one who talks. It was the circus orangutan, the circus, whatever.
Maurice.
And again, he's terrific because, again, he stays through the sequels, by the way. And I feel like there are moments where
Most of them do. Koba is in the sequel. Rocket's in the sequel.
Yeah,
Maurice,
I mean, they stay
is in
with
the sequel.
I love the Maurice character. I mean, like, sometimes when you look at his face, he doesn't even have to move. You know exactly where what he's thinking or how he. I mean, it's like you see his person just in his face. It shows so much of his personality. You know, I mean, again, not to skip ahead, but when they get to the last one, the third one, and you see him on the horse with the little girl on the back, And he's looking at Caesar. He's like, he doesn't even have to speak. They knew exactly who to put the girl with because he's got this look like he's giving Caesar a dirty look. Like, don't look at this girl funny. You know, I mean, it's kind of, again, those simple choices were just brilliant.
You know, from what I understand, as the movie progressed for the motion capture stuff, like, Serkis was directing most of that, which doesn't surprise me.
Yeah.
The man is expressive as hell.
Yes, absolutely. It doesn't surprise me at all either. And you're right. I mean, his performance is, I mean, there's so many times when I'm looking at him and looking at the gestures that he's doing as the ape. And it's almost like they really went the extra mile to really get into what, you know, how, monkeys and apes, how they, the facial expressions, how they communicate different, you know, excitement and fear. And I mean, he really runs with that. So it's almost like they could have done this in, they didn't have to put the effort into it, but the fact that they did really sells it. You know what I mean? Like there's no point. I mean, this is a film where you really, there's, I don't think there's anything in here. This goes beyond, you know, the expression of the animals. Even the dirty corporation, the money grubbing guy, I found all of that to be extremely believable. There really was not, and I can't really think of any part in the story where I kind of went, yeah. Like again, even the guy, the money grubbing CEO, he never really reached the mustache twirling heights. You know, I kind of felt like he always seemed pretty believable. You know, very skeptical at first, and something actually happens that convinces him. And then he rushes forward, and you know, I mean, I kind of felt like it all made a lot of sense. So I mean, I really have to give it to this movie for being, first of all, for just being believable. Like again, it's an intelligent script, an intelligent screenplay, but boy, is it packed with emotions. I mean, the stuff with the father. Wow,
oh,
just that alone. I mean, that stuff alone will tug on your heartstrings and pull you into this story and really get into the motivations of the James Franco character. But then when it sort of goes beyond that and it just becomes about Caesar, and I mean, seriously, you're watching a monkey. Like, and you, like, that goes out of your mind in the first, I don't know how, I mean, when he's going through what he's going through. The decisions he makes, like, I mean, again, you're watching an animal who's watching something happen outside where somebody, his family member is threatened. He goes bananas, excuse the pun.
oh, for God's sake. Low-hanging fruit.
Amen. You know, but and then he goes off and, you know, rips that guy, you know, and then, but you understand it. And then when he's locked up, you understand his frustration. You understand, you see how he's a little almost naive going into that situation. Then he kind of gets like a dose of reality. The frustration.
Like he was sheltered, which was really
a great way to portray it. And then when Franco comes to legitimately take him home and he turns his back on him. It's like, wow. I mean, that again, this story has some depth, has depth that a lot of other films could only wish they had.
The movie smartly starts off by focusing on Franco. Well, technically, it starts off by showing us the capture of Caesar's mother. But then it leads into, you know, with the testing and everything like that. It starts off as the story of Franco. It slowly evolves into the story of Caesar, and literally, when they get to the point where he lets him go into the redwood forest and he climbs up to the top of the redwood and they have that wonderful little montage that shows him jumping through the trees as the years pass.
Yeah.
From the moment that movie said 5 years later, from that moment forward, it was Caesar's movie. And then everybody from the beginning just suddenly became the background character to Caesar's story.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a wonderful way to do that transition.
Yeah.
To make you realize, okay, you know, we've gotten to the point. Now here he is. This is his story from this point forward. And God.
So true. And again, it's so amazing how you can sort of instantly feel from that moment on a change in the tone of the story. Because, I mean, again, it's funny how, I mean, when he's a baby, when he first brings him home and, you know, they kind of do these shots where they're sort of following him all around the house and up to the attic and stuff. I mean, the name that goes through your head is Curious George.
Like, yes, you know what I mean? Exactly. I was thinking the same exact thing.
Totally. Like he at that point he's Curious George. He's a child more or less and having fun and yada yada yada. Right. And then he takes him to the tall trees, whatever you call the
redwoods.
Yeah,
the redwood forest.
He goes crazy, and as soon as he comes back out, it's almost like there's kind of an awkwardness now suddenly, because now he's standing tall, like he's tall, like the height of like a small child, like you know, like a 8-year-old, 7-year-old, 8-year-old,
something
to where the people actually are coming out and going, "Oh my God, is that an ape?" You know, like all of a sudden there's an awkwardness, and you see him kind of getting mildly frustrated. You see him watching the couple, right? You see him watching Franco and his girlfriend. And you can almost tell exactly what's going through his mind without saying a word. Barely speaking a word, he's watching the two of them. And again, now he's in his, you know, quote unquote, this would probably be like his teenage years, his awkward teenage years, where he's looking at girls and getting funny feelings. So you're starting to get the idea of where this is. And again, masterfully done in like you said, just a few frames. When Franco's kind of tugging on his leash a little bit, you know, like even before the words come out, when he says, "Am I a pet?" Like,
yeah,
you know what I mean? Like long before that, you know what he's thinking. You say to yourself, like, it doesn't look right. It looks weird. And again, when he went in and he was a little baby monkey, it was totally fine. Now it looks funny. So, yeah, boy, does this, they convey such incredible amounts of emotion in just, as you said earlier, some facial expressions and just the way the story is molded and constructed.
Yeah. Even the way he carries himself, like when he just kind of, he'll slump his shoulders a little bit when he's like feeling kind of almost insecure.
Yeah.
I love that little body language that they throw into it here, there, and everywhere, because they have to. Because when the big first time he actually says something happens has to be huge. He can't be talking from the beginning. And that's one of the things I love about this, because in lesser hands, they would have had him talking from being a baby.
Yes.
Guaranteed.
Yes, I agree with that. Yes, they easily could have slipped up and did that. But this, I mean, again, they were smart and they treated this like the origin of the Planet of the Apes, the smart, intelligent apes that we will see later on, or well, technically we'll see, you know, later on in the original Planet of the Apes when they get around to that. So yeah, I mean, boy, is this such a masterfully told story.
Yeah. I thought, honestly, I think that was the way to go, because a part of me feels like, you know, do you start off with, like, the I think it was Conquest of the Planet of the Apes. Was it Conquest or Escape? Escape from the Planet of the Apes. Escape from the Planet of the Apes, the original, has Cornelius and I never remember the woman's name.
Zira,
thank you. Okay. Cornelius and Zira, they've gone back in time. They're in modern time. Yes. She's pregnant, and she gives birth to Caesar.
Yeah.
Okay? The movie ends with the awesome Ricardo Montalban at the circus saying, you know, you're just like your mother and father. And walking away, and the monkey just goes, mama, you know?
It's so funny you remember that, too, because I remembered it. And when you said how he would have been talking that's what popped into my head. And I thought, like, well, that's too obscure. He'll never remember that, so I'm not even going to mention it. But I was thinking the same thing.
Dude, I'm a legit fan, dude. You can't hold that on me. I was such a fan that they used to do these little like, appearances at, like, small stages and stuff like that, where people would dress up as the Planet of the Apes and they'd do, like, a variety show. I went to one of those.
Oh, my God. That vaguely rings a bell, just vaguely.
The fact that they didn't go that way was perfect, because I said, the thing that I thought to myself was, well, wait a second. The minute he starts talking, that's the ballgame. In a realistic world, that kid is in a cage and being poked and prodded for the rest of his life.
Yes.
And I said, and I don't want to see that movie.
Yeah.
I've seen Project X and stuff like that, you know, where the apes fight back. I want something better than that.
Yeah. Yeah, and they do the talking stuff extremely sparingly. You know, and I really thought, and I mean, it's funny, I have other thoughts about that, which I'll get to later, but yeah, the fact that they saved it for an epic moment, and again, it wasn't like all of a sudden now he's just talking, like the smart gremlin from Gremlins 2, who just all of a sudden speaks with Tony Randall's voice.
Oh, that was ridiculous, but I like that movie. I have a soft spot for that movie, and someday we're going to cover it.
I agree. But so yeah, I mean, again, that was treated very well. They really did. I mean, this was, they knew that this was more or less just the springboard for other things. And they treated it like that. And so well, I mean, when they finally get around to the part, I mean, it's the buildup is perfect. Like they really did. Again, they treated this like a flesh and blood. It's almost like, you know, the same criticisms I had of Glass when I said, that feels like a short story that was just fluffed and stretched out to fill up 2 hours.
Right.
This is a wonderfully detailed story that really does flesh out every moment. I mean, everything that happens in this film is a stepping stone to what comes next. You know, I mean, it really is. There is the trials and tribulations that, like, one thing leads to this, builds upon itself to the point, again, Caesar, like, when he's finally in a situation where, I mean, again, why he would need a reason to rise up, you know, and to rebel against this situation. You're not going to do it being at home with James Franco and living in his attic and being happy. You know, so everything that happens just really does feel like a natural, intelligent progression. You know, I really can't say enough about the story here. The story and the script, really smartly done.
A character study of an ape and the logical progression in that character study. Amazingly yeah. Well done. Still, even watching it again, I remember when I went to the theater to see this, I went with the biggest damn chip on my shoulder, and I walked out convinced. Mm. I walked out, I want more of this. I want to see more of this. I want to know what happens next.
Yeah.
It's like, screw the originals.
I can't remember now. I'm 90% sure I did see this in the theater, but I can't actually remember. But yeah, I kind of had the same feeling. The first time I saw it, I was totally convinced. This was really, really spot on. And the fact that it's funny too, because it would be sort of tricky to build to a climax that would have the right amount of payoff. But boy, does this one do it. The showdown on the bridge, like when they all bust out and they grab the other apes from the zoo and they're running around with the spears that are from the fence, like, holy, that's, who thought of that? Like, how masterful was that done? What a oh my God, it was so great.
I honestly, if they had ended this movie with just the apes, like, running rampant through the city just to try to get to the Redwoods and stuff like that, I would have been okay with that. But the fact that they had, like, these little fight packs, I was like, you know what? That's good action.
Yeah.
That's some good action sequences that they did there.
Oh my God, it was terrific. I mean, and it's so great, too, because I mean, again, a lesser film would have just had monkeys running down the bridge, bigger and stronger, overtaking the other guys. No. These are smart apes. They climb up and over. They climb underneath. And they flanked the cops, for God's sakes. I mean, how brilliant is that?
I was so good. Oh my God. One little problem. I had one tiny little problem. There's a scene where James Franco and Frida Pinto arrive after the big breakout, and they find the dead body and everything like that, and they find the guy still alive, and then he finds the open can of the Genesis ALZ-113.
Uh-huh.
The little problem I have with that is the fact that he put it out, he basically did it the night before, and like this is like the next day. So you're telling me that these idiots missed that on the floor? It's a little thing. It's not even enough for a who asked you. because I understand why they did it, but it's just something that now you were talking about, it just kind of popped into my head. It's like, oh,
what,
shit.
I don't know. I'm not really sure what you're getting at, though. Who missed it?
The chimp plate. Nobody saw the fact that he had used the smart stuff on the apes. The fact that they didn't see that was one thing, but the fact that he left the cans to be found just didn't feel real to me.
You mean it that Caesar left the cans to be found?
Yeah, that felt sloppy.
Why would he even give a shit?
Because so that nobody knows what the hell is going on until what it's if they too do late.
It? Well, what if? The, well, I mean, well, I mean,
he's Caesar. He's a master planner. Damn it, he should be better than that.
I know, but why would he? Why does he need to cover those tracks? I mean, well, again, see, one of the genius things about this film, again, it's interesting because, I mean, put it this way: when they're actually breaking out of the gorilla sanctuary, like. It's almost funny. It's almost like I think you would be tempted to sort of watch this as like a typical jailbreak movie. But you have to sort of understand that Caesar kind of he doesn't have any sense of, well, you know, maybe there's a reason why I'm in here. Maybe I should stay here or maybe I mean, he is from the get-go a completely unique creation. And he has no concept that he's supposed to be something other than what he is. So the idea that he would need to sort of cover his tracks, well, why? I mean, it's not like, who is he hiding his identity from? If I'm explaining that correctly. Like, why would he feel the need to cover his track?
I see what you're saying.
I went and got that. Now my other friends are smart, and screw you.
And no, but nobody cleaned it up since. Nobody found them before it happened.
Well, James Franco was the first one there.
But that's the thing. I'm talking about the people in the ape sanctuary, like the dude who played Draco Malfoy from Harry Potter, the kid.
Well, one of them is dead, and the other one he locks in the cage.
Yeah, but that doesn't happen until after. My point is that he finds it basically laying on the ground outside of the cages. So it's not like he even hid them in the cages. They were just on the ground. And him and the other guy were supposed to be... And this all happened like... The father left watching the apes as they were gathering together... You know, trying to figure out what the hell they were doing, which was a great
spectacular
shot.
Scene, by the way. What a great moment! Just, I mean, when he walks by and they're just sort of standing there, like standing around having a powwow, and he's like, "What the heck?" And then they kind of look at him and they sort of scatter. Oh my god, that was really cool. I like that moment.
It was an excellent moment.
Because I mean, and again, that's another thing that really could have easily have been done wrong. Like a lesser filmmaker would have had them doing something really interesting or wild or super duper smart. The fact that they're just I almost was having flashbacks of Awakenings.
Oh shoot!
Remember with Robin Williams and Robert De Niro?
Yeah. Holy shoot!
That's I had moments like that where it just felt like they kind of were like they had just sort of woken up and they're just all standing around looking at each other like, okay, so now what do we do? We're all smart. What do we do? We're like, and then when he looks at him, just see them seriously, they look like they should have been smoking cigarettes, like just standing around like people. So I thought like that was, I really liked that again, like just subtle enough, but like, wow, is it a good image?
Yeah, it was a beautiful shot and very well done. But my point still stands is that he's walking out, and that leaves the idiot and his son still sitting there. So they didn't do any of the normal chores of cleaning the place out every night. The monkeys didn't poop or anything like that. They didn't notice these cans. I mean, at least like, you know, show it with like a pile of garbage and make it seem like they found it and threw it out and just didn't even think about it.
I get what you're saying.
It's a small thing. It's not even my who asked you. It's just a small thing that I just thought of as we were talking about. It's like, holy smokes, where did that thing come from? And I wanted to discuss it with you.
Yeah, no, that's fair.
So we have excellent performances. We have an extremely tight screenplay. We've got a running time. I still can't believe this movie was only an hour and 40 minutes.
Mm.
When I saw how fast it was, I was like, holy smokes.
Yeah.
There is actually not a lot of action in this movie. The whole big action sequence happens at the end. This is a character story. This is a think piece right up until that point.
Yeah, completely agree. I mean, it's amazing how much of the first part of the story just takes place in the house. And it's almost sort of a little family drama, you know, like the father's sick and, you know, he meets the new wife and stuff and, you know, they have a nice little family life and the father gets sick again. Yeah, I mean, that's, again, all very heartstrings and really well done. So by the time you start to move on to some of the more action-y scenes, yeah, again, the buildup is terrific. They really do know how to play that. He doled out the action, like you said, very slowly and methodically. So when things started to get crazy, it was like, wow. Again, when you build a very realistic world, what's that?
But the thing is that works because then it feels like it's earned.
Right,
when
exactly.
When that happens. Yeah, exactly. I apologize for interrupting.
We're on the same page. You know, the when you paint a realistic world, then when things go over the top, it works. When I see half-baked scripts where people are just, you know, talking like cartoon characters and doing silly things and things that don't make sense, well, when things get carried away, you're just like, whatever. But yes, when you have a smart story like this, when things get carried away, wow, does it look? I mean, even a simple shot like the first time when the apes have escaped and they did this shot where they're going down the street and the trees, the leaves are dropping, and then they're
That shot.
Yes, very cool. When they're in the city finally, and I think it, like something happens, and the first time somebody throws one of those spears, and they look up, they're. Oh my god, I love that shot because it's like one or
top
two standing,
and they all Caesar comes out, and then they all kind of join him.
Right, they all that sort of shot. Walk out behind him, like they're not all just sort of standing in a row. You know, like they had the sense to have one or two, and then all of them sort of show up at the ledge, and it's like whoa, you know. Again, because they did it in such a realistic way, it works so much better. So, and most, all of the shots like that, just see, at every moment, somebody somewhere was taking a second to say, okay, how would this work in a realistic situation? How can we be sure that this is a realistic representation of what would happen? Like there was nothing felt rushed, nothing felt not thought through. Everything was very smartly done.
And tightly edited. This is one of the
big time.
Best edited movies. It's just really, really well done. Nothing really wasted. No clunky exposition. And I mean, the whole idea of what Franco's character is about, you would think would require a huge amount of clunky exposition.
Mm.
But no, they did it in a form of like a business meeting while, you know, Bright Eyes is losing her shit over people trying to get into the thing.
Yeah.
That was a great way to do it, and still make it part of the plot. It wasn't awkward. I didn't feel awkward about any of the actions or the beats of any of the characters. Heck, even when the Frida Pinto character, when she finds out what it is about Caesar that makes him different, they still take a moment to put aside and kind of work that out. I like that little character beats. I love stuff like that that makes me feel like these are actual people. It makes me care about the people. It makes me care about the characters and the situation. And it makes it so that even when stuff gets ridiculous, I forgive it. So that because they've earned all of it. That sequence on the bridge at the end is the most ridiculous scene that's ever been done in a Planet of the Apes movie. But god darn it, every single second of it was earned and worked.
Totally, absolutely. I couldn't agree more. I'll tell you what though, I will, if there was one scene that I did think was just a tiny little bit over the top, it would have to be the scene where she breaks into the boardroom in the beginning and gets shot like right on the table of the boardroom. You know,
that was a little over the top. Yes.
Basically, just like you know, right at the moment where they're going to get funding for this new project and everything is wonderful, kablam, shot and killed right in the center of the table of the board. And again, not it's a very forgivable thing, and you probably needed something early on with some punch, totally forgivable. And then of course when they sort of explain what happened, you even get a bigger sense of, okay, now I get what that was about. But yeah, that was a tiny little bit over the top. But that's, again, totally forgivable.
We're ready to move on to the next phase. This one.
This is wrong, Will.
This
medicine has the potential to change lives.
Some things aren't meant to be changed.
Does it work?
Like we predicted.
With one exception. The drug has radically boosted brain functioning.
You mean increased intelligence?
It's time!
Time waits for no man.
Time waits for no man. And, brother, we still got two more of these to do, which I'm looking forward to.
Mm.
But, Joe, I'm going to have you start this one off, sir. Joe, out of 10, Rise of the Planet of the Apes.
Rise of the Planet of the Apes. I'll keep this nice and simple and tell you that I am giving this a 9. I really do think this is a spectacular film and a more than worthy tribute to the classic original. And that's pretty rare. That is damn rare. So, yeah, I really do have to tip my hat to this film. This is one of those that I literally enjoy every moment of watching it. There's little to nothing in it that I would change or do differently. A little bit. But not much. And I really kind of feel like this is kind of an underrated gem, frankly. You know, I kind of feel like with a lot of big blockbusters out there, you know, it kind of gets lost in the shuffle, which I think is kind of a shame. But yeah, no, I think this is an incredibly intelligent script. The execution is honestly just masterful. I think all of it was incredibly spot on. And this was a time when, like, I mean, it's not that long ago, but even just as recent as a few years, the CGI was pretty dicey. And this one, boy, did they. I mean, almost like when I talk about Raiders of the Lost Ark and I say, like, they knew enough what they could get away with and what they couldn't. And they kept it, you know, they kept the cards close to their vest and they kept it kind of grounded as much as they could. For a film that's about a thousand gorillas going crazy and becoming smart, I mean, the CGI is really spot on. So, yeah, I mean, pretty much head to toe, this is a great film.
I also gave this movie a 9. I just want the record to show that as anti-remake, as anti-reboot as you and I are, we are also not closed-minded dicks that we can't look at something that took something, and something that obviously we both grew up loving.
Yeah.
Took it, respected it, and yet still added its own flair, its own story to, made it compelling, made it wonderfully acted, beautifully written, expertly shot, and some fine-ass editing that got this 1 hour and 40-minute movie that packs a wallop of information and character building and deconstruction in such a short period of time. I don't know how the hell this movie worked, and it did. Every single frame of this movie, I loved every part of it. One thing felt out of place, but we'll get to that. Nothing really fell out of place too badly. All characters acted in a way that felt logical. Every person acted with gravity for everything that they had to do. I can't be more amazed how much I enjoyed this movie and how much I enjoyed it just watching it again over the weekend.
Mm.
I'm elated that this series exists, and I'm even more happy that we're going to be covering this entire series.
Agreed. I'm with you, my friend.
Wow.
Okay, all right. But it's not perfect.
You got that right. Nope.
All right, again, falling under the category of, again, you know, it's like I've said this before, once in a while, I kind of let this portion, I kind of just treat it as, you know, what's the worst part of the film, but, you know, again, it's really about, well, what would we do differently? And there was one scene that I watched and I kind of said, okay, I would have done that a little differently. And that is the get your hands off me, you damn dirty ape scene.
Aw, I like that.
This is the pinnacle. This is a crucial moment in this story. It's a catalyst, in a way. this is the moment where Caesar is going to speak for the first time, and history changes from here on. And the frustration I have with it is sort of twofold. For a moment like this, that is not when I would have shoehorned in a reference, a fan service reference to the original film. It's not that I mind those moments. You know, there's a part in there when when you're first in the sanctuary and all the animals are going crazy, and that jerky kid goes, "It's a madhouse," you know. Okay, that was a fan service nod if you know the original pretty well.
I actually found that one to be more awkward personally, but please go on.
Yeah. But this one was a little too on the nose, and it works in the story kinda, but again, it's sort of a teenage jerk, you know, suddenly he says something that kind of sounds more like something that a man from the 70s would have said. Get your hands off me, you damn dirty ape. You know, I mean, he's not terrible, but again, it's not even so much that he says it, although it is a little awkward. But again, I kind of find that it's the wrong moment for that, because Caesar is about to speak. And this is, I kind of feel like I said, this is a groundbreaking moment in history, really. I mean, in this world, anyway. And the other part of it that kind of rubs me wrong is that because they're trying to shoehorn that line in there, the actual word no, it doesn't work exactly the right way that I would have thought it worked. Now, again, we're getting into nitpicky territory, I admit this. But, like, when I heard that the first word was no, the picture you get in your head is that the animal is being abused, and in an effort to say no, you're going to stop hitting, you know, no, you're going to stop hitting me. Rather, they twisted it a little bit where Caesar takes the weapon, grabs the kid, and the kid is saying, "Take your hands off me," and he's saying, "No, I won't." So they actually twisted it slightly so that it's a moment where he's actually in the aggressive posture. And again, it works with the story, because I mean, I guess they are, you know, they're changing the dynamic. No, I am not going to be the victim. I will take charge of the situation, and I will be the aggressor. But again, I kind of felt like that line should have been delivered in more of a defensive posture, in a way where he's saying, "No, I'm not going to take your abuse anymore." Which, I mean, again, it's almost like a tiny little twist on, you know, you could say that, well, he is saying, "No, you're not going to abuse me anymore." But again, but when they shoehorn that line is, "Take your hands off me," he's saying, "No, I'm not going to take my hand off of you." And I kind of feel like, again, not a big problem.
I see. You know what? I see what you're saying. I completely understand.
Just something that I would have tweaked a little bit.
I can. All right. I can see that. I'm going to grant you that one because, yeah, when you put it in the context that it's in, you're right. It kind of does clunk a little bit.
Like I said, I mean, not a big deal, but in the spirit of how would I do it differently, that would fall under that category. And you, my friend.
I'm also pretty small. I didn't have a problem with anybody's performance. I had a problem with the neighbor.
okay.
I did. I had a problem with the neighbor. And the first time the neighbor sees Caesar, Caesar's trying to come over and play with the kids. The kids kind of have a freak out. And he's immediately threatening the monkey with a bat and everything like that. And he was just this over-the-top testosterone-y, you know, always on the edge of, you know, screaming. Every single person he runs into, he's a dick to in throughout the entire movie. There's no nuance there. I kind of felt like I understand what his purpose was, but you did such a great job of even giving the freaking, you know, company guy a good characterization that you almost kind of felt bad for him dying at the end. But when this guy gets sneezed on by the assistant, I was like, "Good, you're a jerk." It's like, I felt like there was no nuance in that character, and I would have liked something where it wasn't just that he was just an aggressive character.
Yeah.
Okay? Something. Anything. You know, for God's sakes, maybe they just didn't get along. Maybe he accidentally, you know, ran over their dog. You know, maybe the original story why he doesn't like Franco and the people over there is they ran over his dog. Something. Some kind of backstory for why his instant reaction was aggression to, especially the scene with the father. I mean, yeah, okay, fine, he was upset about the car and stuff like that, but I just kind of felt like that was too over the top, a little bit.
I see where you're coming from. I don't know if I'll agree with you 100%, because I feel like...
Don't have to.
I feel like there's so many people who would listen to this who would be like, oh, no, 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 I have a neighbor like that. I have a neighbor who is just a flat-out jerk for no reason. Yeah, I mean, I know what you're saying, and... You know, there's merit to it, but like the fact that again, the kids are freaking out. There's a wild, in his eyes, there's an animal outside, a weird animal. I don't want to say a wild animal, but I mean, you know,
that's true. He was
an exotic animal for sure. You know, in the backyard with the kids, so naturally a parent would kind of flip out a little bit. You know, I mean, if my kids are in the backyard and they start screaming and there's an owl back there, I'm not going to run out and say, kids, relax. It's just an, you know, I might probably freak out too. And again, I kind of know story wise, I get why that would be, because like you said, when he gets sneezed on and you know, he's about to die, it is a very typical movie trope that says, well, if something bad is going to happen to a random character, I want that character to be a jerk so that you don't even mind when the bad thing actually happens. So it's almost like I could see why he's that way story wise on multiple levels. I wouldn't call him over the top, because I like I said, I kind of feel like any one of us could run into a typical creep any day of the week and not really be that surprised by it.
No, true, but I feel like the reason why it bothers me so much is that they went to such trouble to give just about every other character in the movie at least a compelling motivation, that his lack of motivation like stood out for me. Like I said, it's small. It is so, so damn small.
Yeah.
It's just the only thing that really stuck out to me as, I don't know. It's like, yeah, you're right. If I came in the backyard and Liam's screaming and there's like any animal in there, I'd probably act in a similar fashion. Absolutely. I just feel like after you masterfully had so many parts in this movie that never felt disposable, hell, even the lady he went to try to get his court date moved up didn't feel like a disposable character. Yeah. But this guy did. And I kind of just felt like they could have done
that.
You're
right. I mean, it does have that feel of, okay, we need a jerk for this scene. We need a jerk. Like every time a jerk is required, whether it's the guy, whether it's the beginning part or the middle part or the end part, it's like, the jerk has to show up again because of this. Yeah, I'll give you that. I mean, he was a very one. He was a one. If nothing else, even if he's believable, he's one dimensional.
Yeah,
I'll give you that.
We live in a world now where Ivan Drago is no longer a two dimensional character. So the fact that this guy out Drago's Drago is a big thing now.
There you go. Okay, but. For your consideration. For my consideration? Who's going first? Yeah.
Why bother? I think we're going to say the same thing.
I think you're probably right. And again, there is a lot of good things to choose from, but I think you're right. We do have to kind of give credit where it's due.
Absolutely. Let's start with the screenplay. This isn't my for your consideration. Rick Jaffa and Amanda Silver, great job with the screenplay.
Spectacular.
You took something I didn't think was going to work, and you made it work. James Franco was likable in this movie, and sometimes he's hit or miss. This is one of his hitters, so good on him. Rupert Wyatt, excellent directing. Seriously, excellent, excellent directing. I love a director that remembers that this is a visual medium and trusts the medium to tell the story, and he definitely does that.
Mm.
But we all know who won.
By the way, before we get to it, I also, as you're running down names, I think John Lithgow is tremendous in this film.
He was outstanding.
Very believable at every point, and boy, does that tug on your heartstrings when his last moment when he kind of grabs his hand and says, no, just let's let this go. I mean, that's a very powerful moment, and his performance is spectacular, and he's good in pretty much everything he's in. But yes, go ahead.
Andy Serkis.
There you go.
Andy frickin' Serkis. Who would have thunk that the guy who, when they announced the Lord of the Rings movie, is like, and, you know, character actor Andy Serkis is going to play Gollum. It's like, well, how are they going to do that? How are they going to make that work? Mm. This guy is the reason why they need to start doing best animated character for the frickin' awards series, for God's sake.
Yeah. I'm with you there. I mean, honestly, I kind of feel like if you don't quite get why this is such an amazing thing that he does, like, I mean, again, when you watch Gollum, okay, he's playing a very extreme character. So being over the top is expected. This one is nothing if not nuanced. The way he is able to convey without speaking for 99.9% of the movie, I mean, he is able to convey just so much emotion just by the looks in the eyes and the movement, the facial expressions. I mean, it really is just amazing. I mean, again, like when he comes out of the trees in that park, when he's 5 years later, mm-hmm. and he's looking back, he's looking down, and he's like, when he's looking back at the dog, and you can see him very, very, like, again, those eyes tell you everything. So, I mean, they really just do a masterful job with this.
If you ever want to understand why we feel this man deserves so much more credit than he gets, like, this movie needs more credit than it doesn't get, just look up Andy Serkis, Rise of the Planet of the Apes, and you will find many videos of split screens of showing him doing his performance and how the animators turn that into Caesar. And you'll see the difference. There's no difference. Mm. It's all him.
Yeah.
All they did was frickin' put a mask over him, a digital mask over him. That's it.
Yeah. Absolutely. It really is. It is really tremendous. And again, in a film where there is so much to marvel at, the fact that he shines through so well is very, that's very telling.
And shine on he will, because this is just the beginning.
Yep.
It did say rise, so, well, we rose. And now, next week for episode 104, we will see the dawn of the Planet of the Apes.
Yes, we will. Yes, we will. This is an interesting, going forward will be very interesting, because this was a tough act to follow.
There's a whole tonal shift. There's a tonal shift starting with the second one, too.
Big time. Absolutely, yeah. Big time. It's, it is a wild change in tone. Kind of not too unlike the originals, frankly, because those, they kind of roll over the place, too. So, it'll be interesting to see what we think about it. Because, again, I haven't watched the next two. I haven't seen in a little while. I mean, again, not that old, but I haven't seen them in a while. So I'm looking forward to sitting down with it again and talking about it.
Same here. So until next time, my man.
Good show, my friend.
I love doing this show.
I will see you next week, my friend. Thanks for listening to the Reviews Without Remorse podcast with Joe and Dave. Join us here every Thursday for a new episode. And be sure to check out the Reviews Without Remorse channel on YouTube for spoiler-free reviews of new releases. If you enjoyed this podcast, please consider becoming a patron. You can find our page on patreon.com. As little as $1 a month goes a long way. All clips in this podcast are used for commentary and critique, and is considered fair use. No copyright infringement is intended.
I see from chimpanzee to chimpanzee. No, you'll never make a monkey out of me. Oh my God, I was wrong. It was Earth all along. You finally made a monkey.
Yes, we finally made a monkey.
Yes, you finally Zayas!